Welcome back. In the previous lesson, I talked about exam technique, something I hope will buy you additional time overall in the exam. In this lesson, I want to focus on how you use that time by talking through my technique for answering individual exam questions. So let's jump in as we have a lot to cover, and this is probably one of the most important lessons of the whole course in terms of its effectiveness. Before we work through some examples, let's break down what makes an exam question at the associate level. At the associate level, questions in the AWS exams have a pretty common format. They generally start with one or two lines of preamble, which represents a scenario. Now, this part often doesn't matter. It might talk about a photo sharing website. It might even give it a name. Step one is to learn to skip past things which don't matter and focus on the keywords and concepts which do influence the question. And I'll talk more about this preamble when we look through some examples. So the preamble forms the first part of the question. What follows is the question itself, which at an associate level is usually very brief, generally one line or less. So you've got the preamble, you've got the question itself, and then immediately following that, a number of answers. And at an associate level, commonly that's four or five answers. Now, questions come in two different styles, either multiple choice, where you need to select one answer from a group of answers. And this style is generally about identifying the correct solution from a group of incorrect or less correct answers. And then there's also multi-select, where you can select more than one answer. And this is either multiple parts of a single solution or identifying multiple ways that something can be done correctly. Multi-select questions will generally indicate how many answers to pick. So choose two or choose three. Rarely, though, it can say choose all that apply, and you have to pick whichever answers are appropriate. But generally, these are not present at an associate level. This is something that's found much more at a pro level. At an associate level, you'll either have multiple choice or multi-select, where you're told how many answers to pick. Now, also at an associate level, the overall structure is usually pretty simple. Answers are generally right or wrong. Occasionally, though, you might get questions where there are multiple possible answers, and you have to select the most suitable. These most suitable style questions are much more common at the professional level. From an associate perspective, they are definitely the exception to the rule. So generally, you're picking right and wrong. It's relatively rare that you need to pick the most suitable from a list of answers. Now, another common occurrence at the associate level is that generally questions have at least one answer which can be excluded, and a great tactic is to locate those first. If you can immediately exclude answers from a question, identifying answers which just don't make sense, you can reduce the amount that you have to read and consider. And if you can do that as a first step before you even look at the question, then it significantly reduces the amount of time that you have to spend on that question. If you only need to evaluate between two possible answers rather than four, it's significantly easier. Now, most questions on the exam will have a theme-based overall criteria or a restriction, and these will help direct which answer you select. So what do I mean by that? Well, you might be asked to pick the most cost-effective answer. The scenario might paint the business the question relates to as either cash-strapped or cost-conscious. If there are two answers where both are possible and one is significantly cheaper, if cost is mentioned in the preamble part of the question or the question itself, then you can probably default to the cheaper option. You might also see the term best practice get mentioned. And an example is best practice security. Now, this is a funny term. When you see best practice, I want you to assume that it simply means do what AWS want you to do. A great example is using an EC2 instance role to give permissions to things running on an EC2 instance. AWS recommend this, so in those type of situations, a best practice way of giving permissions to something in an instance is via an instance role. Now, you might also see questions which mention performance. This is often the inverse of cost effective. The question might be asking you to select a product or service which delivers a certain type of performance. An example might be that you're asked to select between EBS volumes and instant store volumes, or the question might want the absolute highest performance option for something. So picking Direct Connect over a site-to-site VPN, because Direct Connect can achieve significantly better performance. In contrast to this, questions might inflict a time frame restriction. For example, if you have 1 week to perform an implementation, that probably means that you can't deploy Direct Connect. So if you have multiple different answers and the question does present a time restriction or a time priority, the first thing you need to do is review the answers and work out exactly how long each of them will take to implement, and then you can quickly exclude any which don't fit into the time window that the question suggests. Now, at this point, I want to step through two example questions and show you how these techniques work in practice. And I've selected these example questions from the AWS official exam questions for this particular exam, and I've linked that attached to this lesson. So let's look at the first sample question. This is the type of question that you might find in an associate level exam. At the top is the preamble and scenario, in the middle is the actual question itself, and below it, four individual answers. And this is an example of a multiple choice question where you have to select one answer from those four options. Now, the first thing that you need to do when you first arrive at a question is to look whether you can eliminate any answers immediately. If we can eliminate answers, we can go from four options to three or two. So sometimes you can identify answers which can be eliminated even before you read the question. Sometimes the wording of the answer just doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. It uses the wrong products, or it uses a feature of a product which you know isn't something that that product offers. Now, in this case, nothing jumps out as being crazy or stupid, and so we can't immediately eliminate any of the answers from this question. The next logical step is to break down what the question means. So we need to identify what matters and what doesn't matter in the preamble and the actual question. Now, this process does come with practice from trying lots of different exam questions, but at a high level, we're trying to find keywords which can impact the answer that we select. And if we can identify those keywords, then we can ignore most of the word usage in the preamble. And for this question, it might look something like this. The grey doesn't matter, the red does. What I've done is to identify the keywords in the question preamble. We don't really care that the question refers to a customer relationship management system or CRM application. We do care, though, that it's running on multiple EC2 instances, that multiple availability zones are involved, and that it's running behind an application load balancer. Generally, what I also try to do is identify what's missing. So throughout the course, you've been exposed to various standard architectures. At this point, you'll know that normally, when you have a load balancer, you'll probably also have auto-scaling groups. But in this question, there's no mention of any auto-scaling groups. Now, understand that by not having an auto-scaling group, you don't benefit from any of the capabilities that the auto-scaling group provides. So you know by now that an auto-scaling group allows you to scale out and in and can auto-provision and auto-terminate instances. And because there isn't an auto-scaling group, then potentially the functionality provided by it is missing from this solution. So keep that in mind. Focus on the fact that there's no auto-scaling group. The next step is you need to identify what the question is really asking. So like the preamble, some parts of the question matter and some don't. In this case, you're being asked if one of the instances fail, then what occurs? Now, one tip that I always try to provide to my students is to look for any amount-based keywords. So if one fails, or if any fails, or if multiple fails, or if all fail. In this case, it's one instance failing. What occurs if one instance fails? Now, at this point, this is a perfect opportunity with what we've identified in the preamble and the question, as well as what's missing from the question, we can go back and look at all of the answers and identify any of them that we can exclude. So we know that there isn't an auto-scaling group. I made a point of highlighting that for this very reason, and that omission of an auto-scaling group means that there's no real ability for the load balancer to terminate or recreate any instances. Remember, it's not the load balancer that can perform any automatic terminations or provisioning, it's the auto-scaling group. And so at this stage, if you look at answers B and C, you'll see the words terminate and replace. And because we don't have an auto-scaling group, we can't perform the steps that are listed in B or C, and so they can be fully excluded. So at this stage, answers B and C are ideal candidates to ignore because there is no auto-scaling group. So as we're working through this question, mentally mark off that B and C potentially can be removed. Only think about B and C anymore in this exercise if A and D don't fit. So next, we can focus on the answers in more detail. Another technique which I use is looking for what I call word fluff. If you have multiple answers which all have the same wording at the start or at the end, then that wording is not actually needed when evaluating those particular answers. So if the same wording is used at the start of, say, answers A and B, then just when you're selecting between A and B, that wording isn't required. In this case, the same wording is used for all four answers. And so when you're logically looking at those four answers, this word fluff has absolutely no meaning. You don't even need to read it. We know that one of these answers is correct, we know that all four of them have the same starting wording, and so we know that none of these words matter. Now, if only certain answers have this wording and others don't, we need to identify whether that is one reason to either pick the answers as possible or exclude them as being impossible. Now, in this particular case, at the associate level, you might not gain all that much time by performing this step, but at a pro level, where each of the answers can be 2 to 3 lines long, by eliminating some of this same wording, you can save yourself significant time and reduce the mental load of evaluating each of these individual answers. Now, in order to reach the point where we can answer this question, we need to look for action keywords in the answers. It's the keywords which matter. And these are those keywords: stop sending requests, terminate, automatically replace, and return 504 gateway timeout errors. Now, we're already ignoring answers B and C because there are no auto-scaling groups involved in either the preamble or the question. So we only have two real options: A, which is to stop sending requests, and D, which is to return a 504 gateway timeout error. So we have to pick between these two answers. So compare these keywords to the question keywords. We know that we're being asked to identify what will happen when one instance fails, not all of them. And earlier in the course, you should remember me saying, if one instance behind a load balancer is working, then the load balancer itself is working. So because the question only states what happens when one instance fails, we know that we will have others, and so it won't return a 504 error. So the only remaining potentially correct answer is A. The final step is to check that A makes sense, that there's nothing wrong or weird, and if we're happy, then A is our answer. If an instance fails, then the load balancer will simply stop sending requests to that instance. It won't 504 as long as at least one instance is active, and it can't terminate or automatically replace instances because there is no auto-scaling group. Okay, so this is the end of part one of this lesson. It was getting a little bit on the long side, and so I wanted to add a break. It's an opportunity just to take a rest or grab a coffee. Part 2 will be continuing immediately from the end of Part 1. So go ahead, complete the video, and when you're ready, join me in Part 2.